Good morning, everyone. So MDA Summer Camp provides thousands of kids with muscular dystrophy and related muscle debilitating diseases the best week of the year. At MDA Summer Camp, kids are living beyond limits in a place where anything is possible. It's a week where they're free to enjoy adventures like archery, swimming, and fishing, developing lifelong friendships, and building self-confidence and independence. Joining us from the Muscular Dystrophy Association are Erin from the New Hampshire main offices and Molly McDermott. And we also today have people from Power Soccer. It is the first competitive sport team sport designed and developed specifically for power wheelchair users. Athletes' disabilities include quadriplegia, multiple sclerosis, muscular dystrophy, cerebral palsy, and many others. The game is played in a gymnasium on a regulation basketball court. Two teams of four players attack, defend, and spin kick a 13-inch soccer ball in a skilled and challenging game similar to able-bodied soccer. Joining us to talk about power soccer is Kim D'Amato, power soccer volunteer, Tripp Johnson, a former coach and father of Will Johnson, a current power soccer player.
Hi, I'm Molly. I'm from the Muscular Dystrophy Association in Massachusetts. Thanks for having us here. We're coming here to talk about our summer camp, but then we also wanted to show you, that's the power soccer tie-in, something that we do at summer camp. A lot of our campers are very interested in power soccer. Great way to, you know, be able to get into the game. So I'll start out by telling you a little about MDA, the Muscular Dystrophy Association. We have about 100,000 individuals served by MDA last year. We cover 43 neuromuscular diseases, and our diseases range from, we cover from infant to adults. Some of our more people that we have registered are Duchenne families, which typically affects males. So I was very excited when I saw a couple males come in the room, because at our summer camp, we pair our campers with our counselors on a one-on-one ratio, and we need a lot of males. So we love the females. We would love to have all you here as well, but we definitely, from 10, age 10 and up, we like to make sure that they're partnered with a male just for comfort reasons. A part of our 43 neuromuscular diseases, we do cover ALS, which people sometimes don't realize. I cover an ALS clinic, Erin covers an ALS clinic. We cover children's clinics, so a typical work week for us is going to clinics and offering resources to families. So it could be a resource such as camp. We have a loaner equipment program that if anyone who's registered with the MDA needs to borrow any durable medical equipment, from rollators, which are the walkers with wheels and seats, to hospital beds, to power wheelchairs. We try to make these things accessible for families, because as soon as they get the diagnosis, life basically changes. And they learn the new vocabulary, they need the new equipment, so the MDA likes to be able to provide that. We have support groups, we do educational events, so we're all around in the community. Big drive is our summer camp, which is what we're here today to talk about. We call it the best week of the summer because it really is for the kids. So I'll let you read the rest. I don't want to do that, but
yeah. So the mission at MDA is Cure, Care, Champion. Cure, we want to accelerate treatments and find cures for these diseases. So our goal over the next 5 years is to fund a lot more money into more research. Currently, we have over 250 research projects that go on annually in over 16 countries. And we want to care for families from day one. So we have our multidisciplinary clinics so that families, as soon as they receive that diagnosis, they can go and have a multidisciplinary approach, really address all the different needs that are going to come up and address all the different questions at no cost to these families either. And then we want to champion. We want to empower families. We want to raise awareness in their communities and really provide those resources for them. Unfortunately, one of the first things you do when you get a diagnosis is you go and you research it and you Google it, and it's very alarming for some of the things that you see. So we really try to provide additional research from our teams and also just to kind of navigate resources with them. It's very overwhelming when you get a diagnosis like muscular dystrophy. So we try to provide that support for them so they don't feel alone, connect them to other families, and really take that approach with them. Sorry.
Yeah, no, you're fine. So in the pictures here are some of our campers, some things that go on at camp. Our campers are awesome, so very cute, smiling faces. Kids with muscular dystrophy and related diseases that limit muscle strength and mobility experience progressive muscle weakness, have weak muscles that can affect everyday freedom, such as the ability to walk, stand, talk, hug, get dressed, eat, or even breathe, but they're kids. So having this week, offering this week to them, they're able to do what, you know, maybe big brother, big sister are going to a summer camp or going to a basketball game or, you know, just doing things that we all do. This week, we make sure that every child that comes to camp is able to do whatever they want. So if we're offering archery, some may not want to do it, but that's with every camp. But we offer, we have swimming and fishing, boating, archery, a lot of cool and like night activities. So we do a karaoke night, we do a prom, we have a DJ come out, and it's probably, I think this picture's from prom, some of the Miss Massachusetts, Miss Maine come, one of our campers definitely loves to borrow their crown and sash. I mean, it's a typical camp. Just the thing that's so wonderful about it is anything goes, that the kids can take part in any activity that we can offer. Which I know a lot of you are going into, you know, helping out kids with special needs, and this is the best week of the summer for these kids.
At MDA, we have over 75 camps that take place nationwide, and the commonality between all of them is they're barrier-free, and they're fully accessible for all of these kids. We provide different activities for them. We make sure that they're paired at the one-to-one ratio so that if they need assistance, they have that so that they can participate. You know, some kids can hold a fishing rod but may not have the ability to cast it. So pairing that, it just makes it limitless. They can do anything that they want to do at these camps. And that's our goal. We want to increase self-esteem and confidence and really just get them connecting with their peers. At our summer camp in Maine, we'll have about 90 to 92 campers. That number always fluctuates a little bit because you never know what's going to come up. And we always have some stragglers. But we want to show you a camp video that one of our volunteers actually took from summer camp this past summer so you can kind of get the feel of what the camp environment's like. Yeah. Sinking inside, and the masts and lines are broken down tonight. I swallow my pride, but we're drowning in the ocean, and it's tearing my heart open, baby. We're having a low first, it's yes, then it's no, and we're changing like the tides, yeah. You, I need you, and I guarantee you we'll make it out alive. Cause I don't wanna fight no more. Even when the waves get rough, I don't wanna see the day we say we've had enough. And I don't wanna fight this war. Bullets coming off our lips, but we stick to our guns and we love like battleships. Like battleships. Fly through the air, and I know that we're both playing not so fair. Oh, show me you care. Got my white flag up and it's waving, cause you know this love's worth saving, baby. We're having, we're low first, it's yes and it's no, and we're changing like the tide, yeah. I want you, I need you, and I guarantee you we'll make it out alive. Cause I don't wanna fight no more. Even when
inside. Can we finally put our weapons down tonight? 'Cause I don't wanna fight.
So that's not even the whole week. I'm going to say it is going to be the most exhausting week of your life, but honestly, it's going to be the best week of your life as well. A lot of our past counselors have come back and said to us, you know, we have to. We're going to figure it out. Maybe they have a job, and they're like, we will figure out this week. We have to go back. You're going to meet some of the people that are going to be, and it sounds so cheesy, but they're going to be your friends for life. Just because you form this bond, you're in a cabin with five or six boys that are 10 or under, and these become your, you've met them the day before, and they become your best friends because you don't know these kids, they don't know you. You need to, you know, you learn to rely on the other counselors. They learn to rely on you. A lot of technique comes in. You learn some lifting. There's, I interviewed a counselor the other day that's returning, and she said, you know what, I took these classes, and I learned how to do different things, and being able to do it in real life, I had some other people in my cabin that showed me easier ways, or ways that I didn't think of, that, you know, made it easier for the camper. So you're going to get a lot of real life experience by volunteering at camp. A typical week is not a typical week. We don't ask you to, you're not going to have to come up with activities on your own, even though we'd like to have your input on activities. The part where you're gonna, where you saw our former camper Will, that was a made up game. It was raining that day. So some of our counselors came together and were trying to figure out something with a ball and a barrel and whatever, which is kind of how I see you guys, you know, working in the clinic, having these games that maybe, you know, aren't mainstream for the kids. We have a sponsor day during the week. So anyone that sponsors MDA activities will come out and do a carnival for the kids. The National Guard, we're painting faces. Lowe's comes out and does car races, just different things so the kids can have a fun time at the carnival. We do a firefighter night where the firefighters will come in from Maine, New Hampshire, Massachusetts, and play activities, do an Olympics with the kids. We do the prom, which was on there. Very cool. Kids will get dressed up. DJ comes in. Karaoke wasn't on there. We missed out a lot. A lot of Kelly Clarksons out there in our camp. We have activities lined up, so it's not something that you're killing time, you know, trying to figure out what to do. It's a very busy week. So a typical day would be waking up, getting the morning meds, going to the cafeteria, having breakfast, and then we do morning activities. Could be archery, could be swimming, could be boating, arts and crafts, everything, you know, normal camp. Then we will have meet for lunch, and then there's a rest period, which everyone will appreciate. I can guarantee you if you're there, you will be waiting for that rest period. So we let our kids recharge, our counselors recharge, and then we go strong after rest period. We will have two activities and dinner, and then another activity, which is where we can bring in things like power soccer. You saw Maine Adaptive was there, and they brought the bikes in. So it's giving the kids a lot of opportunities that they can go home and say, you know, I rode this bike. It was easy for me because I could pedal with my hands. You know, let's look into that. Or, you know, power soccer. Let me join a team. Let me, you know, let my brother and sister come and cheer me on. So it is the best week for the kids, definitely.
on Saturday, you guys will be crying when your camper leaves. I guarantee it. Because you make this bond with that. You're their support. You're their help for that week. And it could be something, we have kids of many different levels. So it could be something as easy as, you know, maybe just assisting with, you know, helping them get their clothes together, different things like that, to, you know, definitely doing the transfers, doing the lifts, helping them with their toileting and bathing and different things. So you're basically their lifeline for that week, and you're the reason that they're able to go to the camp. That's why we come out here to talk to college students to see what we can do and get counselors. When I moved the slide.
I did.
Oh, you did?
Yeah.
Okay, great. We can't have a successful summer camp without you. You're by the camper side day and night, pushing wheelchairs, lifting, transferring youngsters, assisting with daily living tasks, bathing, dressing, toileting, providing assistance with activities as needed, and participating in activities with your camper. So the camp is a one-on-one ratio. So definitely why we're always looking for male counselors. We have a huge Duchenne population, and that mainly affects almost all our males that are diagnosed with Duchenne. So we definitely need, when they hit the age 10, we definitely need to have a male counselor with a male camper. Lots of great activities, like I said, things that you may never thought you would do. I touched a fish last year. Don't do that. You do it for the kids. I mean, it's the greatest week of the year. It's most exhausting, I'm not gonna lie. So you have that disclaimer. It is the most exhausting, but like I said, we have counselors that come back that make sure that they can get that week off just because it changed their life forever. So we would love to have you.
Excellent.
Yeah.
Want me to go?
Yeah, go for it. So there's many benefits to volunteering with the Muscular Dystrophy Association. To take some, one standpoint would be that it's good on a resume, of course. It's about 140 hours with direct care with these kids. And not only are you paired with your camper, so you really get to learn them, their disease, what they go through morning to night, but you're with other counselors and their campers, so you're really seeing a full gamut. We cover 43 neuromuscular diseases, so at camp you're going to see the full range. Of course, we have our higher populations in Duchenne and SMA, but we have so many different diagnoses for you guys to look at and observe. We can provide references going forward. We've done that for many students as they're applying for graduate school, looking for jobs, things like that. But most importantly, you are really changing the life of these kids. When they start their academic year, it's not the same as when they end their year. You know, segueing off of camp, the confidence, the self-esteem, everything is just so much higher. They're willing to participate and try new things and just go outside of their comfort zone, because at camp, they're willing to take those steps as well because they're surrounded by their peers. There's no judgment. Everybody understands, and it's tailored to them. So there's just so many benefits to working with us, and we'll, of course, work with you. We want you to get out of it what you want to get out of it as well. So as long as you're open about, you know, different things that you might want to see or try or different ideas you have, we're more than willing to listen to that as well. Keep doing that.
Thanks.
There you go.
So finally, our camp is at Agassiz Village in Poland, Maine.
Off the grid is what I call it, in Boston. It's August 14th to August 20th. So you'll show up August 14th. And there's a training, so there will be a one-day training, so it'll be all the counselors. You'll find out where you're living, you know, who's in your room, everything. You'll learn a little bit about your camper. Then the 15th, the campers will show up, so it'll be Monday through Saturday. You're usually out in the early afternoon on Saturday, maybe one or two, crying your way home to wherever you're going. But you will... On check-in day, you'll meet with the parents, and so you'll know a little bit about your camper, and then you can ask the parents everything else, and they will share until their heart's content. They will give you every bit of information. We know a lot of our campers as well, so if, you know, anything should arise, we can definitely, you know, maybe talk you through it or, you know, contact the parents. So you will learn about this child. You'll learn about it. A little bit about the disease, and you'll learn about making it the best week of their summer and the best week of yours. We have Erin's information.
her contact information there. I have some flyers that I'll give you, and then we also have some papers to pass out if you'd like us to send you the link to apply for camp.
One of the most important things when you're coming to camp, as much as we can give you information, and of course the parents know their kids very well, the campers know themselves. They know what they like. They know how to be how they like to be transferred. They know they're going to be your best teachers for the week. So no matter what we can provide you or what parents can provide you, which is very valuable, those kids are going to tell you. And they're not shy. They'll tell you. And they're used to new people at times. You know, they usually have to have people at school and really anywhere they go if parents aren't there to assist them. So I just want you to kind of throw that out there that they are going to be your best teachers for that week.
Do you guys have any questions for us?
Excellent. Does it come at any cost to the counselors?
No. Thank you. It is no cost to the counselors. You're paid in our huge gratitude. It is a volunteer program. And it also, just so you know, if you know any kids, there's no cost for the camp to kids that are registered with us. So it's a free week of camp, and you know, definitely, I can't guarantee the quality of meals, but you get meals. Room and board are taken care of.
I will go on record saying we have a new food service this year. So there's my disclaimer. What I fought for this year.
Excellent. Achieved. Very good.
Yes. About how big is their grounds?
It's 400 acres, and it's on Thompson Lake. We'll have the full camp this year. Last year we were mixed because Agassiz Village was training their counselors for the summer, but this year we have the whole camp to ourselves since we're at the end of the summer, but it is 400 acres.
And it's one of our former healthcare wanted to always say this. The dining hall is the largest log cabin
in the country.
North America, or in the country, And it's huge. So some of the games we would play on rain days would be in there. And then there's a, I call it City Hall, it's probably called something else, but we would do game nights there. So there's a lot of very cool areas that, you know, we have huge grounds, but we also have very cool areas for rain
delays.
Yes.
About how many campers and camp counselors are there?
So anywhere from 90 to about 95. Yeah, no, that's no. We like to reiterate because I need as many of you as possible.
We'll actually have probably about 130 counselors, because that'll also include leadership team. So 15 cabin heads plus 5 activity leads, plus we'll have a full 8 to 10 nurses. And then we're also going to be able to bring in some nursing students to work as part of the medical team. So it'll be a full house, about 230. People or so, I'd say.
Yes.
How did you both get involved with MDA?
You want to take it or give you it?
Sure. My background is in psychology and sociology, and when I first started after school, I actually was in community mental health. And as much as I love that, I did that for a few years. I was actually just relocating, and I wanted something that kind of touched on different aspects. You know, I liked being able to provide some of the fundraising to raise the research and really make a change, but I also really enjoyed the direct support for families. So I found MDA, and this is where I've been for 5 years.
I'm actually a communication major. So,
shocking.
So I wanted to do producing of sports. Graduating, I found out there weren't many jobs for me other than freelance jobs. So I found a job with the American Cancer Society. I'm from Ohio originally. And I found a job with the American Cancer Society, loved it. I worked there for about 9 years. Then I realized I wanted to move to Boston because I lived in Cleveland. And so I had a friend who had cancer, and I met him through the American Cancer Society. He was diagnosed with ALS. And so I saw that the Muscular Dystrophy Association was hiring in the Boston area. And so I made the jump, love it, because I really never intended to go into medical. Blood and anything like that grosses me out. But just being able to help people, I found that, you know, I love doing that. So didn't expect to be in this, but love it and love the families.
You said you're one-on-one.
So I think there were 5 or 6 campers in a cabin.
So
with the exception of our boys, we have one cabin with our boys 10 and over. We have multiple cabins with boys 10 and over, but there's one that's maybe a little bit more involved. And I believe I found out recently that they called it their frat house. Was not aware of that. But that one, you'll have more like, I don't know, Will, you were in there. Do you remember about how many campers? Like 15, at least.
But they were individual rooms. I mean, you guys had
like two rooms.
Yeah, two rooms.
Right? Yeah. So that's the only cabin that's more unique. All the other ones are open settings, bunk beds, about 5 to 6 campers, and the equivalent for counselor.
Mm-hmm. And all in the same about age range, and usually with pretty much the same needs. We try to put that together. Yes.
So if there is a girl counselor paired with like a younger boy counselor,
yep.
How does rooming with them go?
So the females and the males will stay together. Those are the only ones that, and it's kind of 10 and under. It's kind of like you're their surrogate mom for the week. I hate to say it that way, but they definitely see it as that. A lot of our boys, when they turn 11, are like, I don't get a lady anymore. You know, they're kind of, and we're, no, you don't get a lady anymore. It's definitely, you know, and you have 6 other moms in there helping you. So it's you know, it's a unique situation that you may not be used to, but they pick it up very quickly, and it's pretty easy. Yes.
Where would you say, like, the farthest camper comes from? Like, which, like, farthest out of state? Or?
We have a kid from Rhode Island, and we have some people from Vermont.
I have people from very far up in Maine.
And yeah,
like
very far. Yeah, Maine itself is a beast. But
yeah.
And then Western Mass, we have a few people.
Yeah, and I have a handful that come from Vermont too.
And I think probably the biggest population is Massachusetts that goes to camp.
Yep.
Yeah. Yes.
How far away is it, like, from Boston?
So it took me about under 3 hours. I make stops. There was a Tim Hortons, there isn't anymore. So, I made stops on the way, but it took me about 3 hours. You go off the grid, I'm not gonna lie, but yeah, you're off the grid for a little bit. Yeah. Yes.
What's the age range of your campers, and when does your deadline to apply to people?
6 to 17 are our campers. A lot of them are 10 and over boys.
Mm-hmm.
Deadline May.
I would say beginning of May.
Soon as possible for females, definitely, because we guys cover yours. We get a lot of wonderful females. Ladies are like willing to do this. Definitely, you know, get it in as soon as possible. I would say yes.
And also, what is the application process look like for someone
who's volunteering? So we have. I have a paper that I'm going to pass around, and you can fill out your information. We will send you a link, so you do it all online, and then we will contact you and do an interview. So 2 of us will come out and do an interview, and then after the interview, you'll still put, you have to have 3 references, a physical, you know, all your paperwork in order, and then we'll let you know.
Yeah, the physical and immunizations for everybody comes usually, because everybody has to go home typically from college, so it usually comes in like the beginning of the summer. But as long as like the interview and the background check, those are the typical things that once those are done and they come back good and everything's going well, you're pretty much a shoo-in. It's just getting the rest of the documents. And the 3 references, you'll actually, when you fill out the application, have those on hand, because you'll fill them out right there, and it'll automatically send them a form, and then they'll just submit it in. And for us.
Yes.
What do you look for in like the female applicants that like stand some apart? Since you said like a lot of women
before. Yeah. Usually when we do the interview, we'll know if you'll make it. it's a tough week. It's you know, definitely, and we lay it out, if you know, I lay out exactly what the week's gonna look like. And sometimes people will say, you know, I'm going to try. Usually the people that are like, I'm going to try, turn out to be great counselors. They just don't realize they have it in them. Just, you know, the willingness, mm-hmm. and the the caring that you want to do this. And we, last year we were limited to the females we could take because we didn't have the whole camp. This year we can expand that, and we'd like to have, you know, as many as we can, just because sometimes you need a break, sometimes you need a little extra help. So we want to make sure that everything's stacked in the best favor for our campers. So
I think, given any experience you got, judging by the program that we're talking to right now, mm-hmm. already kind of puts you a mm-hmm. foot up, just because you have the experience and you've been outside of your comfort zone, I would guess, a little bit, which camp is great, but you still have to adjust, just like any situation. But it's just the willingness to do that. And when we interview, you can tell, like, just based, they're just typical questions, but you can tell in the conversation, it's just a willingness to kind of step outside, try new things. You don't have to be the most outgoing person, but honestly, it's just being there and wanting to make that week amazing for those kids, and just being able to step outside your comfort zone a little bit is really, really what we look for. No specific requirements are needed.
Good dancers. Yes.
Where does MDA get their funding from?
Yeah. So throughout the year, we do close to 9,000 events across the country. So we are a nonprofit. So we raise that way. We do a lot of applications for grants. Our firefighters are a huge sponsor for us. So they, if you've ever seen the Fill the Boot campaign, that money goes to us. So we have a lot of community partners.
The Shamrocks
in that way.
That are out now.
Yes, so buy a Shamrock.
Yes, Dunkin' Donuts, you know, different in every market. That goes to MDA.
But it's really just fundraising events that we help put on throughout the year.
Mm-hmm. Lots of fundraising. And there's Muscle Walks coming up. Mm-hmm. So if you guys want to know about that, definitely let us know. We call those our big family reunions. We get a lot of campers at our Muscle Walks. So if you're in the mm-hmm. Boston area or New Hampshire or Maine, mm-hmm. I want to see what the camp population looks like, we'd love you to come. Excellent. I'm going to turn it over to Power Soccer then. Which is a great about, jump on there, is a little, which is a great, they come in for a day and the kids love it. We have kids that aren't necessarily ever going to be in a wheelchair that get to work and practice this. And I just had one camper. We asked them what their favorite part of summer camp was, and this is a girl that has CMT, so is ambulatory, and she said power soccer, hands down. So I think we'll share a little bit about power soccer.
Just gonna show a video real quick.
All right, okay. So do you want to start with the video, or you want to? Yeah, one of you guys, I'm going to find a video.
Okay.
All right. All right.
Thank you for having us. My name is Tripp Johnson. I'm William's dad. William has SMA. He's the youngest of three kids, so his older sister and brother both were very athletic, spent a lot of time on fields and courts, and he obviously was on the sidelines watching them. About, what, 5 years ago now? 6 years ago? When he was younger, he was actually at an MDA camp in the summer. It's up in New Hampshire. It wasn't the one in Maine. It was in New Hampshire. And Kim D'Amato, this is Kim, and another woman showed up for Power Soccer Day. And William was there and plopped him in a chair. And he took to it like a fish, like, fixed the water, or ducked the water, I guess. This.
See you later.
It basically was, all of a sudden, there was an opportunity for William as a kid, as a disabled kid, to participate in a sport that was designed for him. It wasn't adapted. It wasn't, let's go play baseball and we're going to change the game a little bit so William can play. It was Power Soccer was designed, set up, and they compete basically at an even level playing this game. And so it was a great opportunity. And all of a sudden, William found those competitive aspects of his life and the things that he wished he could do on a field with his brothers and sisters, he can now do on a court. And so that's what Power Soccer kind of stepped in. And he, again, it's become what he does outside of school, and this is his activity. This is his sport.
Brad does a mix between bumper cars and soccer, and its popularity continues to grow. News 18 video journalist Austin Miller has more on the game of power soccer.
The name of the game is Power Soccer. And it's giving people with severe disabilities the chance to play a sport independently.
We have children out here that are on respirators and ventilators. We have kids that are playing with feeding tubes, and there's nothing that's stopping them. They can get out there and play independently just like any other able-bodied kid can play soccer.
And just like soccer, the rules can be quite confusing, but there is no denying the joy it brings to these players.
Being out on the court is a lot of fun because it's the most competitive thing I can do now. And I love going back to Purdue and telling all my friends how many goals I got this weekend.
We got up at 5. It's about a 2.5-hour drive, so not too bad. I like the morning, so it wasn't too bad. But it's definitely worth it. Indiana has the most power soccer teams in the country. So if this is where we got to come to beat up on some Indiana teams, then this is where we're going to come. I've always looked for a sport that was competitive and fun and strategic and demanding, and I always liked team sports. So when I found power soccer, I was really happy because it's all of those things and more.
Powered by 2 car batteries, these $8,000 chairs travel just over 5 miles an hour, which may seem slow, but once you get out there, it can be a humbling experience.
It's not so easy. You know, my kids have been in power chairs since they were 2 years old, so I'm used to driving a power chair around. When you get in these chairs, they are so sensitive. You barely touch the joystick, and the thing is jumping and it's moving, and it's incredible how these kids can control it.
Founded in 2006, the United States Power Soccer Association has helped create over 100 teams throughout the country. And while the game is still young, it has given athletes a chance to travel the world to places like Australia, Japan, and France, where the last World Cup was played.
It's really cool to say that I'm, you know, a World Cup winner. Before I played, I would normally just sit in my room and play Xbox or something like that. And now I have something to do, social, to get out and you know, travel the world, meet new people everywhere.
The sport continues to grow. With 17 countries now playing, Karen says the next step is to become the first power wheelchair sport at the 2020 Paralympics. Austin Miller, News 18.
It is played internationally. Indiana, they mentioned Indiana. Indiana is, seems to be right now very much a hotbed of power soccer. Although New England, with Kim's help specifically, but and there's also another gentleman, Tony Jackson, who's just come out to the area, who works at the USPSA level. He's from Arizona. He's very much involved, and he is building a program in New Hampshire. But Massachusetts has a number of teams. William plays for a team out of Canton, out of Mass Hospital School. There's a team in Boston. There's a team in New Hampshire. How many teams do you actually have there?
Three or four.
So yeah. So Tony's organization has a handful of teams, and that's out of UNH.
We have 3 teams at UNH.
UNH, yeah. So, and where else? There's Vermont, also has a team. There's the Maine team. Is there a team in Maine at this point?
No,
they have not. Okay. There's some interest. What you find is, and Kim has been doing this with Tony, traveling around, is going into going to MDA events, going to different programs, and kind of presenting to the disabled public or disabled community, this sport. And I think you guys, it sounds like you're dealing with a group this morning, and you have been over the last few months, of a group of kids that come in, and you'd be surprised how many of those kids had never seen power soccer, and how interested they would be if they could get involved with it. And I'm not saying they're certainly welcome to get involved with it. I think
there's an organization here in Bridgewater
that
wants to connect with people here at the Bridge Center.
Yeah.
Are you guys familiar with that?
Yeah, so Anna Wood, who's actually William's former coach at Sudbury, and Anna was actually the one along with Kim that got William involved in power soccer. She's involved at the Bridge Center, and she does. They're trying to build a program in this immediate area, but there are certainly kids that potentially are in your program that could be involved at the Mass Hospital School. The Boston team is really older, so
yeah,
they're not really. It's older. When I say older, they're adults typically, and William actually practices with them in the summer and such. And they're great people, but it's not a kid, you know, it's not a kid-oriented team. Whereas William's team at Mass Hospital School, they range in age from what? Nolan's like 13, I think, 14. Yeah, 13, 14 to 21. Okay, so that's a little younger age range. Whereas Boston, I think, is playing 30 to 59 age. Again, you'll see if you see these videos. I encourage you, if you're interested in power soccer, YouTube is a great place to go out and see some of the things you can see. A, you can see how the game's played, and B, you can kind of get a feel for the dynamics of it in the organizations, and there's a lot of kind of interesting information out there. As far as power soccer, as far as the game goes itself, anyone's played soccer, there's a lot of rules that are similar in the sense of, rules are, that's not true. The rules are the same in the sense you have throw-ins, but they're kick-ins, you have goal kicks, you have corner kicks, there's a goalie box, okay, there are penalty kicks, things like that. But then there are aspects of the game that they had to adapt the rules, the soccer rules, to kind of make it work for power soccer and such. Is there anything?
No, we don't start off in a chair like this.
I was going to say, yeah, so that's a good point. So
yeah. You can adapt.
William is in a chair, and you saw a couple of them here. These are, let me roll on here, William, real quick. These are the $8,000 or $7,000 chairs they were talking about. This is a design specifically for power soccer. And the thing that's different about this compared to this chair is this is built for speed and it's low to the ground, okay? And he'll show you in a second how quickly it spins. But it's designed specifically for power soccer. This is not William's chair, so it's not fitted to him. He has a similar chair that he plays in, okay? And go ahead.
This is tough to drive.
Yeah, it's very sensitive. But the thing that's unique about these chairs, and specific to power soccer, is they're very quick turning. So, we're not going to do much here. So, why don't you just spin around? You have space to spin around there, so you can just spin. So, can you spin? The controller, as you can see, his little position there. Go try to spin it around. See how it goes. So, Well, anyway, I'll roll the ball back and forth. We'll see how this works. So, this is a power soccer ball, which is 13 inches in diameter. It's it's bouncing just like anything. When William's spinning and the ball's moving around the court, it can get airborne. One thing about power soccer is you can tell with these kids, it's a two-dimensional game. It's played on the ground. Okay, the ball, once it gets in the air, they can't play it. So it's not like soccer in the sense that you can play over a teammate. Although there are situations where the ball can't travel over a guard.
There are rules.
There are rules about height, though.
Yeah, it's like, what, 20?
20 inches.
Yeah. 20 inches. If it goes 20 inches above, it becomes a dead ball and it's a play for everyone else. But these guards are not 20 inches.
Right.
So a goalie in this chair, the ball can go over the guard and it would still count as a goal.
It doesn't happen very often, but that can come into play. But that's more the news of the game. But as far as this is the game the ball is played with, it's played. Like I said, two dimensions, so the ball is basically moved back and forth. Like soccer, I'm sure that out here there's probably a number of you played soccer, at least as a kid, right? In soccer as a little kid, I refer to it as amoeba ball, which is the ball's in the middle and the camera kind of goes around it and plays around it and pushes it around and it kind of moves around with the group of kids around it and then squirts out and they chase after it. Power soccer can look a lot like that when they're first starting, just because of the fact that all you really know is to get close to the ball. There are rules acting in the game to prevent that, though, because there's a two-on-one rule, which doesn't allow you to have more than, you can't have a teammate, and you can't be on the ball against an opponent. So it's a whole idea, you can't have two defenders, even two offensive players too, but really, it's really, basically, you can't have two defenders covering one offensive player with the ball. Again, a minutia of the game, but it allows you, it forces you to kind of spread out. But as the game level of skill increases, and you'll see it again if you look at some of these videos, you'll see that the court, they spread out on the court and they move the ball, and then it becomes a very kind of fun game to watch and very exciting because it is fast paced. They are spinning and moving the ball around the court and making passes and shots and such. But as far as, so that's the game, it's a, I'm sorry, two-dimensional. There are four kids on the court one time per team, so there's a goalie who has special goalie privileges and then three offensive players, although obviously there's a defensive responsibility, okay? It's a lot like sports have like defensive offensive players. I guess a basketball you cover, right? Soccer typically has...
What he's saying is there is no defense offense. There are wings and a center. There is no, like...
Exactly. Right. Right. So you have responsibilities both ways. That's right. Exactly. The center typically plays back and plays in the box on the defensive end. But so you want to roll the ball back and forth a little bit, show how the ball moves, or is it even? You can try. Okay. So there's a couple of different aspects to this game. When you initially start, you're basically pushing the ball, bumping it with the guard here, and as you can see, come forward a little bit so you're in the middle here. There's a metal guard that goes all the way around this chair. There's also some guards on the wheels.
And the back.
And the back. And this is more for safety purposes, so the ball doesn't get under the chair in some manner.
Which has happened.
Which has happened. Kids actually, I mean, it's not common, but it doesn't happen as much with these chairs, but other chairs, when they were adapting more common chairs like this, and they were just putting a guard on it, you would have some, you know, his regular permobil there. They would put a, you could put a guard on the front of it, and in fact, when we're introducing the sport to kids, we'll get plastic guards or metal guards that we can easily attach to these chairs. We'll put them on just so they can go out and kind of bump the ball around the court, kind of push it around and get a feel for it. When you graduate to something like this and you learn how to kind of play a little more, you're playing again with this chair, which is more designed for the game, but there's still protective guarding around it, and it's basically to keep the ball from getting under the chair and creating popping it, having it pop up. But when you first start, the basic thing you're looking to do is just push the ball back and forth. So redirect the ball off the guard, you know, he's just gonna push it back. And he can move it pretty quickly and hit it pretty hard with just pushing that way. As you get better with the game, you'll see kids start to do spin kicks, you start passing the ball off the side of your chair. They also dribble the ball, carry it down the court. You know, again, can't show it here. We could go over and show it in the gym at some point. You know, what might make sense, especially, who's the gentleman who was up here speaking earlier? Anthony came up, but is that someone else who's running this program?
Who's running, but...
Okay. So, one of the things you may want to consider doing is having one of your Saturdays, one of the things that we do is come in and show you how power soccer works with the kids. You know, kind of organize that, and maybe even a situation where we sit down and we kind of identify the kids that might make sense to kind of bring into a game, you know, situation or something like that. Because I think that's the best way to show you, is put you on an open court and kind of play a little bit. But I'm not going to do much more here. I think it's just too dangerous for this, with this chair. It just looks wicked. We're banging the wall with our ruining thing. As far as your involvement with Power Soccer, I coached William's team when his other team dissolved. I pulled together a team and I coached him for a year. Humbling experience. And when I said because it wasn't awful. Well, okay, so here's the problem. So I'm a competitive person. Blaine's a competitive person. I was pushing him and his team to kind of practice more and do more. And I was like, we can figure this out. We can figure out how to play like these guys play. I was probably, my expectations were a little high, and so I probably was
a little high.
When William started to dread power soccer practice is when I realized that I was that we had to kind of calm down. And the situation where he could join the Mass Hospital School team, which is a very competitive team. And he was able to join that team, and it was good for me and good for him, and probably good for the two of us to get away from that. But as far as what you guys can do as far as power soccer is concerned, you can get involved volunteering. There's need for referees. If you've ever done soccer refereeing, that's one thing. But I mean, there's a need for that. I actually now ref games. Actually, we're having a game today. But I've stepped into doing officiating, which is a need. Just supporting teams in general. I mean, when these kids arrive or when adults arrive to the court, they got to get transferred in a chair or their chair's got to get adapted. That kind of help is invaluable. Kim has been, you know, the patron saint of power soccer in New England. She shows up at all these games and venues and just repairs chairs, you know, fixes things and stuff like that. I mean, I'm not that you're a mechanic, but you can, but that kind of support and help. But getting involved, and I think with what's going on here, with the kids you're working with, maybe showing them the sport and getting them involved, which means getting us back or getting someone back to show you the sport, and then working to get those kids or those adults into situations and onto teams where they can play. Wayne, you can speak to the experience. What does power soccer mean to you as far as, you know, in your day-to-day life or in what you do as a sophomore in high school?
That's something I can finally say. If friends are like saying, "Oh, I'm really good at the sport," I'm like, "I'll put you in a chair and I will destroy you."
Okay, fair enough. Right, that's good. Okay, I like that. That's true.
It's great. I do a lot of stuff with sports. I manage, and then a couple sports. I've wanted to bring in chairs just to play around because a lot of people, they're interested when I talk about it because most people have never heard of it.
Sure.
And then there are some people who have heard of it because they knew someone or something, but for school,
it makes homework harder to do because it is a practice halfway through the week. And so
there's an aspect. I mean, his brothers and sisters went through the whole thing, and as you were athletes, as you would as well. It's that whole dynamic of organizing your time because you have practice, right? And so now William has that aspect in his life where he has practice. He has to adapt his school schedule around that and make sure that he gets his work done and things like that, which I think is, you know, a great life skill as far as learning how to organize time and such. But I think for these kids, the biggest thing for them is the opportunity to be competitive, and it's really truly a sport that's designed for them and for their abilities. And you really, I mean, you think, okay, put someone in a chair, you know, everyone's got the same chair. What's the athletic ability there? And you'd be surprised at the hand-eye coordination, the strength, you know, his ability to spin around and keep oriented, keep, you know, there's a whole field sense, a whole aspect of the game that is not necessarily equal for everyone that's involved, right? So you very quickly see separation between who the better power soccer player than who is. I mean, the equipment makes a difference, don't get me wrong. Putting someone in this chair versus another, versus a slower chair is gonna make a difference. But, you know, at the higher levels, and these chairs are becoming pretty much the standard, even across New England, even some of these less competitive teams, people are finding ways to pay for these chairs, and they're in the game. But even then, you'll see the difference. So it's just a great opportunity for these kids to compete and really show what they can do. And have fun. I mean, William spends, you know, it's an hour and a half or so practice every Wednesday at Mass Hospital School, and then we play games on the weekends. But he's there with a group of kids, like issues, you know, to say kids in power chairs. Some have SMA, some are Duchenne, some are whatever their disability are. They have common issues, and so they're from there. They'll get together and kind of spend some time and, you know, chat informally about stuff and what have you is a nice opportunity as well.
And it goes for the parents as well.
Yes, absolutely. So one of the comments, one of the things, you don't have to build into your presentation because you're not talking really much to parents, but the whole NBA camp thing, the best week of your summer kind of scenario. Well, for the parents that get the week off, not that we don't love our kids, but it's probably the best week of the summer for the kids as well. We miss our kids, but they may not miss us, obviously, but it is that NBA camp experience is great for the parents as well. Tough the first year, but it's a great experience for the parents as well. You know, their kids are out having to do something different and fun, and with other people. Because, let's be honest, the NBA experience in camp is just the beginning to what the kids are going to experience for the rest of their lives. In other words, they're going to have to start relying on PCAs and other people to support them, and so you give them a little bit of an opportunity to do that in a very controlled and safe environment. They get used to it. You know, parents get used to it. Us letting go of it. So that's another aspect of NBA camp. So great program to be involved with. As far as power soccer is concerned, can you think of anything else you want to touch on?
America's won all World Cups.
Oh, yeah, there you go. Exactly. We're very competitive internationally. The next World Cup, I think it's not 2000. Was that? Yeah, they won in 2011 was the first World Cup, and I think it was in Tokyo or Paris, I can't remember. Paris was the last one.
Yeah. I thought it was.
And they have one coming up. They have one coming in the U.S. The U.S. soon. U.S. is hosting, I think, in 2017. Yeah. Anyway, William's dream is to be involved with U.S. power soccer. He's actually been to a power soccer camp in Minnesota, and we're planning to go back, trying to go back again in the summer. For those of you, again, just to throw out another piece of information, there's a foundation called the Challenge Athlete Foundation. They actually provide funding for all kinds of different things depending on what your athlete's needs are. So if you have a kid that you're working with that is interested in an athletic program, they will help pay for camps, they'll help pay for chairs, they'll help pay for things like that. You have to talk with the parents and get them involved, or if the kid is old enough and they're on their own, they can apply for those kinds of funding. So that's when William got his power soccer chair. Some of the funding came from Challenge Athletes Fund. And we actually went to camp with money from them.
Camp Courage.
Is
it called?
It's Camp Courage in Minnesota.
Yeah.
It's where the power soccer program was. It's the exciting thing, I guess, as far as the takeaway from power soccer is that it's something that's growing internationally, growing a lot in the U.S., and more importantly, we are now kind of holding New England. New England started to really develop teams, and there's growth here and interest here. Due in no small part to what Kim's done around New England, and then programs like the Mass Hospital School and what's going on at the UNH continue to build that program. So, open up to questions. Anyone have questions about the sport or about the organization? Yeah.
I have a couple questions for William, if that's okay.
Oh, go right ahead.
Does it get super aggressive, and do you ever get dizzy doing the spin kicks? I feel like I get so dizzy.
Recently in practice, I do get motion sick if I spin way too much, so that's fun. aggressiveness, it is a yellow card if you ram someone directly. I have gotten my fair share. But if you're going to the ball, you can get away with a lot of stuff. But if you're going to the ball and you happen to run into someone in their front yard, you're fine. They'll say, calm down. I don't know about dizziness for a lot of people. There are some people who have trouble with it, but eventually you learn to just not think about it, I guess. And don't think about it because you're thinking about how to not screw up. So
I would say absolutely kids have different levels of ability, and being dizzy or being in Lynch's case, motion sickness seems to be a new thing for his practice. But you addressed that Dramamine. I think it was the Dramamine the other day. That helped. Well, not right now. But we have a game later today. Doesn't seem to be a problem. Doesn't seem to be an issue with games for William anyways. It seems to only be a problem in practice. And I think it's more of the repetitive aspect of practice. You're doing spin kicks over and over and over again to do the same play. Whereas in the game, it's game situation. So you're traveling around and you're thinking about other things as well. You're focused more on the game itself. It is a fast-paced game, and again, I encourage you, if you're interested, to go out and find some videos, especially the World Cup games and things like that. Those are out on
YouTube. There's a tournament next month.
Yeah, so in New England, so there's a couple things. We're playing today, which doesn't help you guys probably, but we're playing in the Tobin Center against the Boston team. Williams Mass Hospital School team is going up to Boston to play against that team, and they're a very competitive team. Both those, that'll be very close, and those should be good games. And then on the 19th of March, which I think you guys, it sounds like you guys are on break, which is great. We're going to be in Vermont playing. We'll play against Vermont. I think Montreal might be there.
Yep, UNH.
UNH is going to come, Boston. So that'll be a local, the regional tournament that goes on there.
There's one in April.
April, we have, I don't know exactly the date. I want to say it's the middle of April sometime. I don't remember it though. But in the middle of April, there's a Mass Hospital School is hosting a tournament. Again, similar teams. And one of the issues you run into in power soccer is that there are not a lot of teams. You have to travel distances, so it's trying to figure out how to get everyone together in places and compete and play. And you have some requirements so that at the national level, we can compete for the national championships in four different levels. There's a premier, which is the top champions, presidents, and founders of the four divisions. Now, William plays on a team that's in the presidents, right? Yeah, Presidents, which is the second one. And their championships this year are in Indiana. So we're headed out there in June. Last year, luckily enough, they were New England. They were hosted in New England. So we'll be playing in April in Canton, Mass Hospital School, which is not far from here. And that'll be an all-day tournament, and there'll be five or six teams there. We were hoping to get Syracuse to come in. Syracuse is a national champion from this past year. They won, so there's a team out of Syracuse that's been together for about 10 years. Now, they're older. I mean, those guys were all in their 30s, I think.
Yeah, there's a couple of young ones. Not that one, but
okay. Late. Yeah. So, like anything, the one thing that's great about power soccer is you can play it later in your life. It's not as... the physical demands are still there, but you seem to be able to be competitive and successful, later in their athletic lives per se. So William at 16 is going to have, he's got a number of years to play power soccer. But even so, you still see that the national team is still made up of kids in that 18 to 26, 27, 28, just like any athletic event. You'll see the best ones are in that prime athletic age. But a few kids, and a few 40-year-olds that are really good at this game as well. So hopefully we'll end up doing as well. So, yes?
Now, is there any training that you need to go to be a coach?
Coach, no. It's just like any soccer.
Actually, if you go to a rep training, you can actually get paid to host.
That's right. Yeah, so the answer to your question is, it's the coaching piece, there is no formal training per se. I mean, other than you want to have, just for your own pride, you want to kind of have a feel for what the game is, but it's really herding cats, like any, like youth soccer. You go out there and you, you know, throw the ball out, you give them some drills, you make sure they don't run off into the woods. Well, same thing these guys did. They just can't typically leave the court, but it's all keeping them focused and stuff like that and figuring out drills. If you're interested in coaching at all, first thing I do is contact a team and talk to a coach and come in. We have at Mass Hospital School, we have kids there all the time that are involved. There are nursing programs, so they're there kind of, again, like you guys will be looking at the adaptive sports and opportunities and kind of seeing how these work and supporting that. But if you're interested in coaching, I would contact a team and say, you know, do you mind if I come down and watch your program and see what's going on and volunteer to help there, and you can get exposure. And then, you know, and then it's a matter of, and I think what it sounds to me like is there's a great number of potential players in the group you guys are working with on every Saturday. You might be able to create a team right out of this area. And you know, what you need for a team is, I would say 6 players, probably on a team as a minimum, to make practice manageable. Like we did, so our team last year, the Sudbury team that I took over, we had 5 players and we had typically 3 to practice. It was difficult to make practice work. We had to be very creative on drills. But the Mass Hospital School team, they had 8 plus kids, so we'll be able to scrimmage every practice just about, which is nice. But I would say 6 players on a team, again, to try and field the team. You got to have 4 on a team. You're going to have kids that are sick, especially kids with these are compromised. They're susceptible, especially in the time. You know, the sport is played in the fall and the spring, just like regular soccer is. In the fall into the winter time, you're going to compete with basketball teams for court time, so that's one aspect that's kind of difficult. Makes it challenging, but once you get to springtime, not many people are on the basketball court, so things open up and certainly into the summertime. What's that?
Volleyball.
Mm-hmm. It's not as big an issue with the HL volleyball team. Basically. So yeah, so I would start with yes.
How do you go about like becoming like a referee?
They have clinics.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yes.
I could give you my card or something, and you could contact me, and I can connect you with Tony.
What time do you guys prepare to wrap up?
We have to. Yeah, right. Right.
I think that probably the best thing to do would be to set up something where we come back and actually get onto a gym floor and show you soccer and work with the kids. I think that's probably your best.
Definitely. So, on behalf of CPDC, we'd like to present all of you guys with T-shirts.
Thank you.